Okay then, I think we'll go ahead and get started. We're so glad that all of you here to join us today for our panel at the Ruins of Pop Culture, Saving the World from Story. I'm Professor Scott Jordan, and Casey is on the Scott and Cognitive Psychologist Philosopher at Illinois State University. Coming to you today as Detective Josephus Miller for the series. Is the expanse, the whole molecule is change. And that's part of what we're going to talk about today, is the changes you go through, the most traumatizing events. So what I'd like my panelists to do is introduce themselves, tell them a little something about what you do, and then say just a bit about the story you're going to discuss. You're first.
So I'm Brittany Oliver Ciesco-Barrow.
So this is where she started today, and we'll show you where she ends up when we get to the end. So, many contemporary popular culture narratives depict characters that are struggling to sustain their identities in a tension between an earlier, disrupted, possibly traumatized version of themselves and their current self. In HP's Lovecraft Country, Misha Green transformed H.P. Lovecraft's cosmic fear of minorities and immigrants. She showed us the types of traumas marginalized persons experience on a daily basis in Lovecraft's idealized New England. Now, what I want to talk about in this, in my bit here, is as our bodies move forward day-to-day life, our sense of time and space move with them. In other words, the argument is that our sense of a time and place are constrained and supplied by our bodies. And as those bodies move away from the moment of trauma, that increases the psychological distance between the traumatized self and the current self. And the thing to remember is that traumatized persons manage their suffering by creating psychological voids or ruins that keep the unclaimed experience of the traumatized self separate from, but yet connected to, the current self. What Trigg refers to as the impossibility of completion. And this is not meant to be simply analytic, it's meant to be descriptive of what it feels like to live this type of life. So in Lovecraft Country, Montrose Freeman's traumatic experiences in general, and the Tulsa Massacre of 1921 specifically, disrupt his developing identity as a black gay male, resulting in an experiential void in which he masks his former self via alcohol, heterosexual marriage, and being a father. So the reason I put this image up here is because I think this is probably the most beautiful depiction of the voids traumatized people create for themselves. So what you have here, you can't see it very well, the lights are perhaps a bit bright. This is Montrose Freeman, who was raised in Tulsa, was at the Tulsa Massacre of 1921, saw his boyfriend murdered. Now he's been asked to come back to Tulsa in the present day, or actually present day, because someone in his family has been cursed, and he needs to go back to Tulsa to collect the Book of Names so they can bring the Book of Names forward into the present so that they can use a spell to save her. Now, what this scene depicts, if someone could possibly turn the lights down, because they worked very hard to make this image work. You can barely see Montrose, the figure of the wonderful, thank you. You can see the image of a man standing in the middle. That's Montrose Freeman looking out over the burning Greenwood district of Tulsa. And in that space, you also see, you can't see it well, but there's a pulsating blue blob up in the left-hand corner of the image. If you saw the show, you saw the blob. What that blob is a vortex, a portal that can take Montrose back to the present. It can also take him to any possible future. So what Misha Green has accomplished here is to put you in the psychological space traumatized people live in. The past is in my present with all of these beautiful, potentially wonderful futures pulsating in the same space. And what I want to argue, and the purpose of the panel, is as we experience these voids, as we watch people go through this, we can better understand the anxiety of living a disrupted identity that feels like it's impossible to complete. And as we see more and more stories about these feelings of incompleteness and the divided selves traumatized persons live in, it may enhance our empathy for the traumatized while also becoming an increasingly normative aspect of how we experience ourselves. So that's what I want to say about Lovecraft Country. If any of the panelists have any quick comments they want to make, what we're going to do here is each one of us is going to talk about a story, and then we're going to open it up to questions. So
I think that's something that's really exciting for Lovecraft Country is that it allows culture to be discussed.
Yes.
It allows the experience, it allows the struggles, it allows
sat down to record it, I actually wore a coat and tie. And they said, why do you wear a coat and tie? See, this is a sacred office.
Yeah.
This truly is a sacred office. You can go back to this and be put in the state of what it was like in ways that are, I would argue, spiritual.
Yeah.
So I highly recommend it.
I'm
from the island of Guam. There's very few AAPI representation, and I grew up in a household that I was raised by a black father, and I was raised by a Vietnamese mother, and you know, to I mean, like I'm older here than probably a lot of the folks here on the panel, but like I remember the Green Book, you know.
Yes.
I remember all of this stuff, and so when I watched the show, it had a really great impact on me because I was like, this is oral tradition passed down, visualized, which was awesome. And it was like, you know, I remember traveling in the South and, you know, trying to go to a diner. We didn't know which one was safe, and like my dad said, okay, we can't go to this one. And I'm, you know, like 7, and I'm like, why not, Dad? You know, it smells good in here, you know?
No idea.
Right? And so the best way I can describe the show, it's what's scarier, you know, the explicit, you know, racism or fictionalized monsters. And so that's why this was really impactful for me, because the fake monsters were so much less scary. And so, I mean, like, real life is scarier. So that was like what was really impactful, and like understanding, like, yeah, you know, these are, I can't take off my brown skin. You know, this is, you know, the things that I talk about when I talk to other school psychologists, I tell them there's the explicit bias and the implicit bias. So what is explicit bias? We all know what explicit bias is. It's easy. He's racist. Da, 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 da. That's racist. You call out your racist uncle, you know, during Thanksgiving, right? But like, the implicit bias is the work that we need to work on. Harvard does a really great survey if you want to see what your own implicit biases are, which I find very interesting, because I found out, like, oh my gosh, I have these implicit bias of many things, and those are the things I need to work on.
Exactly. Yeah. No, I'm taking care of, we're going to go ahead and go to monsters.
Yes.
You're up, and it's not here, you have to work up there, so you look into my seats.
Okay, so I would be focusing on One Division. I am a trained and certified Greek researcher and facilitator. And so we're thinking about One Division and how she experienced the quote unquote void.
Yes.
If you guys don't know, in 2008, there was a study. Essentially, starting in China, went to the U.S., and it was individuals who experienced the death of their child, and they went to do VR, so virtual reality. And so they used these tools to help with grief. The argument is trust, and yet it's not something that's really deeply expressed. It's not something that's really deeply explored. We have this universal experience, and yet it's not something that's prioritized. And I think that for the first part of this show, it shows that the humanity of the experience, and it's not just the humanity, it is that I can struggle, and then sometimes I struggle well. When I talk, and I've talked on this podcast before about saying recovery does not mean recovered, it means that I'm still experiencing this thing. I'm still going through it, I'm still working to see how I grow and learn and figure things out. And grief is one of those things that is so minimized. We get 3 days, okay? We get 3 days to have the biggest loss in our entire life. 3 days to lose your mom, or lose your partner, or lose your friend, or lose your uncle. My uncle just died, and they were like, well, it doesn't count. Because he's not a part of our, policy, it's that immediate family. Grief is hard, it's complicated, and it looks different all the time. Sometimes people cry, sometimes people are dismissive, sometimes people are distant, and this is why it's one of the hardest things to research. And for WandaVision, I think that it's because you see her struggle. And so often in shows, we see a hero, and yet she still is one, despite the fact that she's going through an enormous experience. And so we like a hero's tale, like to champion someone, like to go beyond the means, and here is someone who's falling apart, appreciating because she's lost someone. And who amongst us hasn't had that experience?
What I love about what they did with WandaVision was the whole town was her void. The whole town was her ruin. And all it was an amplification of regular grief. And we mixed grief with some chaos magic and boom. I thought it was important for people to see the slow deconstruction of the void as bits popped through, and she started to have to deal with the fact that she was lived doing this by herself was stunning. And they had her fly off of the air. That's got to come back to the MCU. She's got to be accountable. Even though she was a hero in terms of her own trauma, there's other people that she traumatized, and they have to deal with it. And it's Liz.
Yeah, I really like how they did that with talking about, can my kid just come out for a day in the show, right? Let me just be with him for a day. Like, you lost somebody, not only once, but you lost them twice in, 3 minutes, right? Because she had to kill him, and then Thanos brought him back and killed him again.
Yep.
So that's adding more grief on top of grief. She had to deal with what she went through, and then what he did. And then putting the people in the city of Westview like that, it traumatized everything. There's a lot of guilt and complex issues that get piled on. And it's just like a Coke bottle getting shaken up. It exploded into Westview.
Well, this is a situation about accountability. Am I accountable for my experience? Am I accountable for my trauma? And the answer is yes and no. Yes, I have these things that have happened to me that are problematic and it's difficult and I react one way. And yet, there is a societal expectation that that you are still good and you're still fine and that you figure life out despite the fact that bad things have happened to you. And that's an interesting concept for WandaVision. And yes, all these very traumatic things have happened to you. Your brother died, your parents died. You had to kill the person that you love for the sake of humanity. And yet, you're fine. And I think that that be fine, be okay, be regular is the toughest part of the human experience. Because we all struggle, all of us.
And they show it to us. They show it to us.
Yeah, we have to.
Exactly. I mean, let's go ahead and go on to the Winter Soldier.
Sure. I just want to add one thing with what Brittany was saying too, is I'm a big Supernatural fan. I don't know if anybody else here is. But Jared Leckie was on a podcast, and I actually use this with my clients. And he said, trauma is not your fault. Recovery is your responsibility. And it kind of rolls in with Winter Soldier. Even talking about Wanda kind of goes in with what I'm going to cover a little bit, because we all, are there any non-MCU fans?
Yeah.
Batman is my favorite, but yes. Because we're talking about these characters, and we have 25 movies, all these TV shows, and you get to see how things are played out throughout the series, which I really love that the MCU has been doing with. When it comes to therapy, when it comes to having traumas, when it comes to showing it, even movies later, on what's going on. So with the Winter Soldier, you know, PTSD is a thing that's been talked about a lot in the last 10 years. Everybody's heard of PTSD, but a lot of people don't really understand what PTSD is. And it's having an experience, a traumatic experience, often with loss of life or limb, or somebody else's loss of life, seeing it, and having these issues following that for a few months. We all go through these symptoms, but for some of us, our reset switch doesn't get flipped, and that's when it becomes PTSD. So we're talking about the Winter Soldier, we're talking about James Buchanan Barnes, and what he goes through, and what his symptoms look like. You know, the DSM that Brittany referenced earlier is the book for clinicians to say, hey, in order to have this diagnosis, you need to meet this criteria. So the criteria for PTSD is having hypervigilance. How many people after a car crash don't get a little nervous when you're driving? Right? You're on the road, you're scanning a little bit more. Maybe you're not able to drive. And that's often a result of this. We have re-experiencing our flashbacks. Those thoughts, those intrusive thoughts, those memories. We have stuff with Bucky when we're looking at Civil War, when he's talking to Steve and Sam. What did I do? He's so detached because of the programming he went through Project X and when the Russians become a super soldier. As I talk, and there's things going on out there, I'll reference some of it. These are from a series called The Longest Winter. It came out in 2012. It's a 19-run series, but it really covers what he's experienced, what he has gone through, and how he's trying to make amends, which is even talked about in Falcon and Winter Soldier. So we also have emotional numbing. And you see him really struggling to make any connection aside from Steve. And he even talks about that in one of the first episodes of Falcon and Winter Soldier. He's like, that shield is the closest thing I have to family. And if Steve was wrong about you, Sam, then he's wrong about me. And then that hits us even harder. Because people who struggle with traumatic injuries, people who struggle with mental health diagnosis, often struggle with self-esteem and self-worth. So he's already beating himself up on top of this. And then we have isolation and avoidance, which is the glue of PTSD. It's what holds all the other three symptoms together. Because you see him living by himself, staying on, so he sleeps on a mattress on the floor in Civil War, right? And what is he sleeping on in Falcon Winter Soldier? The floor, just next to a couch. And he wakes up with those nightmares. He wakes up with those intrusive thoughts, those dreams. And then he has therapy, and he lies to his therapist. Which, as a therapist, I'll tell you, lying to your therapist doesn't help you get closer to recovery. Just throw that out there. Yeah. We could talk for an hour. But it's not super helpful unless you're willing to open up before, which is the scariest thing. And everybody in here has that ability, and that's our superpower. We can be heroic by being vulnerable, by saying, hey, you kids, I'm fucked up. Right? And that's okay. It happens. Again, trauma is not our fault. Recovery is our responsibility. It's a thing think we have power and control over. So we look at Bucky, who was in World War II, who was introduced as a kid sidekick to Steve in 1941, and then later brought on as Sergeant Buchanan Barnes, what we see him as the MMC of the First Avenger, and he's going through issues there. He's going through issues there, and you see him struggle there. You see those things. What people don't understand, because PTSD's been talked about for 10 years, 15 years because of the wars, is it's been around since the dawn of time. It's mentioned in the Bible when you talk about some things there with David and Solomon and things like that. So it's kind of interesting that then it's mentioned, and here we're still learning about it. Really, since like 2005 is when mental health professionals have really dug deep into it to figure out how to help. So how do we see this in Bucky? And I kind of mentioned, we see those nightmares, those intrusive thoughts, those things of like, how can I be better? What can I do? What did I do? Taking ownership, taking that bit of personal responsibility, which is so huge when it comes to mental health. So that personal responsibility and awareness, you can't really make change. And then you see in comics and in the movies, like, and the TV show, how do I make amends? How do I balance it? How do I right my wrongs? Which is a struggle for all of us. And it's taking that piece, and it's learning about us and willing to say, like, hey, I was kind of a shit person for a little while, and I'm gonna make it up. I'm sorry, genuinely.
And they actually showed this. Showed them doing
it. Yeah, when you're looking at, I forget his last name, the son who we killed, where he's having a flashback, and he's getting to be friends with him and taking him to lunch. And then he gets triggered while on a date and goes to him and can't add that piece of first responsibility. It's just like, I forgot I looked at him, and gives him cash. And then later at the end of the series, he owns up. But seeing these things is great. Now, mental health is not always best represented in MCU. That therapist is terrible. But it was cool to see him actually going to therapy.
Yes.
So it's a step in the right direction. She was talking about VR. We see Barf when we're talking about the beginning of the Civil War, right? With Tony and his glasses having that interaction with his parents. So making amends, taking ownership, and working towards kind of adding, loving yourself is what's going to help you in your traumatic, in your traumas.
Well, I think that that's a part of a therapy term of DBT, which is virtual
therapy.
Is this radical acceptance of I can be and exist in this space. All of those things are great. I can love who I am and yet feel like I need to grow. And I think that that's kind of like Bucky's character of I'm sitting in this space where I am the album.
I'm going to do whatever so I can connect with you, right? So I have a kid who is non-binary, and I'm so thankful that we are in this time and age that kids get to explore who they are, who their identity is. We don't live in a world now that things are so oppressed. And so the Owl House, I'm going to have some spoiler alerts because there's season one and season two. Sorry, guys. But this is Ida. Ida is the adult figure who's not really an adult, and I kind of relate to her. But anyway, she's the magical person. So the backstory is that Luz is a Hispanic character. There she is with her two friends. She's human. She is the weirdo in school. Like, she likes to do all the, you know, science experiments. You know, she likes to read books. She's the nerd. She's the geek. Who can relate to that? So anyways, so she finds a portal and she meets Ida and she like gets to know them and she's finally accepted in this weird world of witch world. And she's like, oh my god, I've always wanted to learn about witches. And so she gets to learn about it and she gets to be herself. And celebrate her because she's different and weird and odd. They're like, you're not that odd. The only thing odd about you is that you're human and you've got round ears. So anyways, I love it because it has different characters. This character's name is Rain. Rain is also non-binary. This is like, you know, like, I'm like, wow, like kids on Disney Plus, I get to see this. They get to experience, you know, a different world than we did, most of us here on the panel. So that's Rain, and then Lisa, next one, you can do the next slide. And they actually have a same-sex relationship. So so that's Luz and Amity. And okay, so Ida, this is where we talk about the character where there's the trauma. Ida is cursed in here. She turns into this nasty owl creature, and she doesn't even know who she is. But at the end of season one, she has to make peace with that. And so what's really important in this is that all the trauma, all the grief, all the complex things that we go through, whether it's anxiety, depression, that's what I have to deal with a lot with the kids in high school. We have anxiety, we have depression, especially coming from COVID. And I tell the kids, I tell the families, we have to give each other grace. And you know what? That homework might not be finished, but did you guys connect today? You know, did you reach out and ask your kid how they were doing today? And so that's what we have to come in this process now, as we're coming, you know, to become the new normal with these beautiful masks that I see everybody in. So sometimes I see your face and I don't even recognize who you are. I don't even know you put the mask on. This is our new normal. And so make peace with that anxiety that you have. Make peace that you might have that social anxiety. You know, that we have experienced a collective trauma. And so we need to give each other grace. We might be upset at the person that's taking too long at the gas station. But you know what? They might be having a bad day, so I gotta make peace.
I want to ask a very therapeutic question.
Yes, please.
But why do you think that representation matters?
Uh-huh.
In this show?
Yes, representation matters because it allows reflection of who we are. And that's why I love comic books. I love coming to San Diego Comic-Con. Please have me come back again. another one. But it's important because we did a show last summer. And we just did a show. My husband's a drama teacher, and we did Shrek. And I say we because sometimes I help them. And there, our Shrek, our donkey, we had all representation. And the little girl, well, there was a little girl in the audience, and she looked at the cast members and said, "I can be that person. I can be, you know, I can do that too. And yes, you can do this too. I was one of you guys before."
Hello. I'm happy to go after you, actually. This is another all-ages story that is deceptively sharp about what it's talking about. I read it as a teenager, and I loved it. And then this year, I lost a parent, and I reread it, and it hit me to spoil it for those of you who haven't read it, but if I can get and convince you to read it, then I will have done my job. Basically, it follows Barbara, who is, as you can see, an eccentric middle schooler who doesn't get along with her class. We obviously can't leave the speech balloons up there. But she's kind of your typical, like, cooler, you know, she's cooler than the other kids. This sequence I really liked. She's just an artist because she's like reading D&D on the bus, and the other girls are cracking about the normal stuff they're into. And then I flip to the next slide, and she gets home, and like she was trying to ignore the girls on the bus, but then you can tell that it's sunk in a little bit. As soon as she's alone, she lifts up her shirt and looks at her stomach, and like can tell she just feels like she can't wear the clothes that the popular girls are wearing. And they were talking about like you have to have to wear this kind of shirt. Just think, oh, she's so cool, she's so self-confident, but in her private moments, you see that it's eating her, right? And she gets home, like, next night, please, and she will not go upstairs in her house. For the longest time in the book, you don't know why. You don't know why she won't go upstairs in her house. Every time she's alone, something about upstairs in the house is eating her, right? Next slide, please. I'm getting ahead of myself. Anyway, so, it turns out one of the ways she's coping is she talks about how she's a giant killer. Kills giants, that's her profession. None of the other kids at school understand it. This is a nice one. This is the scene where she's talking to her school guidance counselor, and the school guidance counselor says, we have to talk about, and they crossed it out in the dialogue, and she freaks out and slaps her school guidance counselor, which I hope you've never had.
Well, there's a difference between a school counselor and a school psychologist, but yes, I have been slapped.
So you can see that she's lashing out, and finally, next slide, please. She fights the giant, and the giant finally reveals what has been eating at her this whole time, that is that her mother is dying of cancer, and the giants are her way of coping with this giant thing that you can't wrap your head around, which is mortality. In fact, you love people, you lose them. And it's very strange, and it doesn't feel right. I like it. When I read it, I was like, of course, it feels like you're fighting giants. That's what it is, right? And next slide, please. And she loses, because you do in the end, right? And this panel just broke my heart when I read it. You have to read it. It just paints really beautifully as an artist that she's had this whole fight scene, and the background drops out. And it's just her huge hammer that she's fighting as hard as she can. And she says, but I tried so hard. I really, you know, I tried so hard. Next slide, please. I don't have this memorized, but it ends with it saying, we're stronger than we think. This will take time, we'll get through it. You experience loss. And the book is really nicely written because she finally goes upstairs, plays with her mom, and then it kind of jumps ahead a few months. And you kind of don't see exactly what her process of grieving is like, but it almost feels like it's giving her, as a character, that privacy that is a little different for everybody.
The space.
And it's just a beautiful.
But I think that it's interesting too, is like we have to consider, like as a grief researcher, we have to consider the age of loss. And so what my loss looks at 0 to 5 versus 6 to 12 versus 13 to 15 is gonna look different specific to the time that I lose someone. Not just the time, but who I lost, how it was lost. What was the, we call it the mode of death. Is it uncertain? Is it something that was a diagnosis and it was long term? Like, for her.
If you'd like to ask questions, please feel free to
for her line up at the microphone. It's different and it's a little more symbiotic because of the relationship and because of how she saw the person. And so it's so.
Okay, so what we're going to do now is turn the mic over to you if we have questions. Please, go ahead.
And if you have a good question, you may get my book.
Well, first off, I want to say thank you very much.
Yay! Everyone.
My dad passed away a couple years ago, and we tried first Comic-Con.
And so this is my first one out here.
Oh, so, I'm sorry to hear that. Thank you for sharing.
The VR experiment referred to. I remember vaguely reading about it, but I don't remember the specifics. It was a VR series of the kid that they had lost.
Yeah.
What they decided was a good thing for them.
So what they did is that everything was, all of the videos and phone calls and everything was put into a VR. And so it sounded like that person, it talked to that person, and it responded like that person.
That's awesome.
And it is one of those things that is this helpful or is this hurtful?
Yeah.
Because with grief, right, like we think about like, okay, I'm losing this person. However, is losing them enough? Is losing them the right thing?
Mm-hmm.
And so with having these children come back,
right,
these children be in your life, is this actually helpful? And so there's a little bit of push and pull about like, is this a therapeutic process? Is this therapy with me? But yeah, so they literally did all, and I think it came in the U.S. in 2008 to have phone calls and video and all those other things reincarnated for VR. And they showed that for some people it was helpful, but for some people it was really negative. Right, and so statistically, if you do grief research, if you do grief work, group therapy is the thing that they say do first, because you want to have a community. You want to have people who understand your experience. I was an orphan at 21. You couldn't tell me, someone else, to say, like, I get your experience, but you don't. And so group therapy is the first thing that people suggest. The problem is that group therapy doesn't work long term. Group therapy ends up being something that you just feel sad for after. And so they want to do group therapy, then individual therapy, and then you go on. And so VR for grief is not necessarily long term helpful. Short-term a solution, because it does give you that peace, but at the end of the day, it's going to prolong your grief, and it's not going to actually be like a solution.
Thank you so much.
Sorry.
No, cool, either.
Anybody have a next question?
Curious about generational existential dread and how that affects an individual's processing of trauma. For those of us who grew up in the maybe of the Cold War, process it differently than those of the inevitability of climate change.
Every generation has its own apocalypse, right? And doom and dread have been with the species since it began. When the Berlin Wall came down, the big next apocalypse, you know, that's the stuff. So I mean, generationally, yes, Lovecraft Country was all about generational trauma and how that impacts everything.
You know, I also think that it depends on how you grow up and the awareness, right? Because during the Cold War and even World War II, Vietnam, all those people came back and they experienced it a little bit differently based on what they were telling themselves, their own narrative, right? If I share that I'm hurt, I'm weak, and they start criticizing themselves. Where now, it's in the media, it's in our face, we all know about it, so it's more accepted. We're seeing it on the silver screen. You know, so it's easier for some of us now to process it. And I use a group of Vietnam veterans that I mix in with some of my Iraq and Afghanistan veterans. And that way they give one hope and the other like humility. And like, hey, I've done this, you can do this. So that's the whole piece. I'm like, hey, like, I'm not weak because these guys look to me very similar. I don't like the word same because it invalidates your experience. So we've been through something similar. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Sorry. We have one more question. We have one last question. Hi there. What I wanted to talk about your thoughts on, and Brittany, you had mentioned the Blonde Division, you had mentioned compound grief. And she had lost her parents in bombing, you know about that, and then later she loses her partner. I also wanted to point out that the loss of a partner generally is always compound grief because being widowed myself unexpectedly, I not only lost my wife, but also every plan that we had for our future, that part of my life just disappeared. Mm-hmm. And so that is a compounding effect.
So for compound, the actual description of compound grief is I'm experiencing one loss and then I have another loss. Let's say, for example, I have a loss of a job and then I have a breakup and then I maybe can't leave my house. And so it's
loss of the identification too.
Yeah, so you're going to have this kind of snowball effect of all the things that happen. And with what you're talking about is I have this idea of a relationship, this idea of family unit, this idea of how I am a person with this other person, and all of those things fall apart. And I think that it's really incredibly sensitive to think about all the things that I have lost in this loss. Like, not only do I lose the person, I lose the things. I lose the 6-year-old, the 60 party. I lose the Thanksgiving. I lose the
identification of being a husband, being a partner.
100%. And so it's so much beyond your best friend. It's so much beyond just who you are here today. It is what you've lost tomorrow,
mm-hmm.
in 5 years from now, in 10 years from now.
Okay, so I hate to be the bad guy, but
we got to get. Oh, sorry! Yes.
Before we go, in just a second, though, I want to show you a minute on this final work. And I need a photo with your red dress.
Yeah!
Anyway, for sure. So let's get
going. Okay, we'll finish answering the question later.